حبيب الله. الله our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to him. He wanted humans to be the best and give his best religion to them. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to him. He wanted humans to be the best and give his best religion to them. رسول الله حبيب الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والعاقبة للمتقين، ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأولين والآخرين نبينا محمد وآله وصحبه أجمعين. My dear viewers, welcome to another live edition of Gardens of the Pious, live all the way from Addis Ababa. Today's episode in the new series of the Prophetic Etiquettes and Manners is number 119. The book, which is compiled by Imam Bukhari, may Allah have mercy on him, and that is different than the collection of Sahih al-Imam al-Bukhari. I'd like to remind that this collection of Al-Adab al-Mufrad, or the Prophetic Etiquettes and Manners, contain sound and weak ahadith as well. Some of the ahadith that the Prophet ﷺ said himself, marfu'a, and some which is mawquf, يعني it is the statement of one of the companions, or maybe even one of at-tabi'een, and so on. In today's edition, we'll begin with the chapter of Ijlalul Kabir, honoring and respecting the elderly ones. Hadith number 358 is simply a continuation of the previous episode, in which the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith which is narrated by Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhuma, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ليس منا من لم يرحم صغيرنا ويوقر كبيرنا. The messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in this hadith, anyone who does not show mercy to our youngsters, nor acknowledge the rights of the elders and show respect and honor them, he does not belong to us. He's not one of us. Does it mean that the person who is cruel to the youngster, to the children, and the one who is not respecting and honoring the elders is a kafir? No, it doesn't mean that. Nothing takes a believer out of faith and out of the pain of iman to kufr except declaring kufr or associating others with Allah knowingly in worship, or denying any of what is necessarily known in the deen, such as the mandate of the prayers, refusing to offer what Allah the Almighty has mandated upon us, refusing to fast, saying that I don't believe in fasting, then we don't believe that you're Muslim. I don't believe in Hajj, and I think it's an idol worshiping. Immediately this person, if he is aware of what he's saying, and he chooses to adopt this view, if he has misconceptions, we'll be more than happy to clarify what is vague for him, and to lift the fog and refute the misconception. But after all, if he insists, then he simply chooses to be out of the fold of Islam. But when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says once, لَيْسَ مِنَّا مَنْ لَمْ يُوَقِّرْ كَبِيرَنَا وَأَرْحَمْ صَغِيرَنَا، or لَيْسَ مِنَّا مَنْ لَمْ يَرْحَمْ صَغِيرَنَا وَيُوَقِّرْ كَبِيرَنَا, that simply means the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, a person who is not merciful to the younger ones, and the person who does not honor the elder ones, does not belong to us as far as behavior, as far as akhlaq, as far as attitude. And as you know that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah granted him the honor of intercession and shafa'ah in order for me and you and all of us as Muslims to be eligible for his shafa'ah for his intercession on the day of judgment. In order for us to be able to drink from the basin, from the hawd of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, which is before entering Jannah, we have to comply with his guidance. We have to act upon his sunnah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And if we don't, you risk in and jeopardizing the honor of shafa'a, being eligible of the intercession of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم on the day of judgment. In addition to, obviously, those are major sins. So if a person insists in indulging and practicing such major sins, that means his scale of bad deeds will outweigh the scale of the good deeds. And the Almighty says in the Quran, وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَفَّتْ مَوَازِينُهُ فَأُمُّهُ هَاوِيَةٌ وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا هِيَ نَارٌ حَامِيَةٌ. So the person is a Muslim, is a believer, says لا إله إلا الله محمدٌ رسول الله, and he used to pray, he used to fast, but his bad deeds outweigh his good deeds. فَأُمُّهُ هَاوِيَةٌ, his shelter, his abode will be the fire of hell. May Allah protect us against that. The following hadith, I want you to bear with me. I want you to bear with me because it's a long hadith. And basically, the take out of the hadith is in a brief statement. But since it's narrated, there are a lot of benefits that we're going to learn out of it, inshallah, Azza Jal. It is in the chapter of باب يبدأ الكبير بالكلام والسؤال. The chapter deals with the right of the old person to speak first and to ask first. So whenever we are in a gathering, in a sitting, even if it is dinner, barbecue, community meeting, or a halqa or a dars, or in a courtroom, elders should be given the right to speak first. Then, if they have nothing to say, maybe you switch to the younger ones. Okay? As the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us in general, يُسَلِّمُ الصَّغِيرُ عَلَى الْكَبِيرُ وَالْرَاكِبُ عَلَى الْمَاشِي وَالْمَاشِي عَلَى الْقَاعِدُ. What does it mean? We learned before when we were studying Riyadu al-Salihin about the importance of salam and giving salam to each other. Who should begin as-salam? To begin somebody with saying as-salamu alaykum is recommended. To answer the greeting of somebody who said as-salamu alaykum is compulsory. So, as-saghir, when young people are passing by old people, they should say as-salamu alaykum to the elders. One young person is passing by an elder person, he should begin him with as-salamu alaykum, uncle. As-salamu alaykum, ya ammi. Likewise, those who are riding, they give salam to those who are walking, and those who are walking, they give salam to those who are sitting, and so on. Imagine, these fine details have been explained in depth by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When you think about it, that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, have been explaining everything, even who should give salam to whom, you know, and you should eat with the right hand, and you enter the bathroom with the left foot, and you exit with the right foot, and you say this supplication upon entering, and this supplication upon exiting, and this supplication prior to eating, and this supplication upon finishing eating and drinking. What is this? You don't find this in any religion. Then when some people are suggesting certain awrad or supplication, say, thank you so much, we're not in need. We have enough on our plate. The sunnah is plenty, mashallah. If I just practice the sunnah, I don't have time to do any innovation or any bid'ah, mashallah. Think about it this way. So the hadith which we have, it's only one hadith in the chapter that the elders should be given the right to speak first and ask first before the younger ones. Hadith number 359. Hadith number 359. This hadith, as I said, is a long hadith. And it's a long story. Bear with me. Al-Rafi ibn Khadij وسهل بن أبي حثمة رضي الله عنهما. We have two narrators. We have two narrators. رافع بن خديج and سهل بن أبي حثمة. أنهما حدث أو حدثاه أن عبد الله بن سهل ومحيصة بن مسعود أتيا خيبر فتفرقا في النخل، فقتل عبد الله بن سهل، فجاء عبد الرحمن بن سهل وحويصة ومحيصة ابن مسعود إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، فتكلموا في أمر صاحبهم. فبدأ عبد الرحمن وكان أصغر القوم، فقال له النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: كبر الكبر. قال يحيى: لي الكلام الأكبر. فتكلموا في أمر صاحبهم، فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: استحقوا قتيلكم، أقال صاحبكم بأيمان 50 منكم. قالوا: يا رسول الله، أمر لم نره. قال: فتبرئكم يهود بأيمان 50 منهم. قالوا: يا رسول الله، قوم كفار. ففداه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من قبله. Okay. The meaning of this hadith, simply two narrators, namely Rafi' ibn Khadij and Sahl ibn Abi ibn Hasam, رضي الله عنهما, ibn Abi Hasma, actually, رضي الله عنهما, reported that Abdullah ibn Sahl and Muhayyisa ibn Mas'ud visited Khaybar and parted when they were among the palm trees. The day palm trees. So Abdullah ibn Sahl was murdered. Abdul Rahman ibn Sahl, his brother, and Huwayyisa and Muhayyisa, the two sons of Mas'ud, came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to complain. And they spoke to him about the murder of Abdul Rahman ibn Sahl. So, the murder of Abdullah ibn Sahl. So Abdul Rahman, the younger brother of Abdullah ibn Sahl, who was the youngest of all the speakers and those who were present, began to speak. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, let the oldest speak first. Okay, kabbir al-kibar. So they spoke about their companion, Abdullah ibn Sahl. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked, will 50 of you take an oath that you're entitled to the blood money of your murdered man, Abdullah ibn Sahl? They replied, O Messenger of Allah, this is something which we didn't see. He said, then will the Jews exonerate themselves by oath of 50 of them? The Abdullah, Abdurrahman ibn Sahl, and the two sons of Ibn Mas'ud, both said, Ya Rasulallah, you know that they are unbelievers. You know, if they swear, it will not matter for them. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself paid his blood money to them. So now I want you just to pay attention with me that we have three names. Abdullah ibn Sahl wa Muhayyisa ibn Mas'ud. These two names first, Abdullah ibn Sahl and Muhayyisa ibn Mas'ud. Both of these companions, they traveled to Khaybar. What is Khaybar? Khaybar is a Jewish settlement, and he was about 173 kilometers from Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara. Okay? They happened to part. They entered into the date palm tree. Khaybar was full of date palm trees. And we said before that the Jewish tribes, whether Banu Qaynuqa, Banu Nadir, Banu Qurayza, who settled in Yathrib, Al-Madinah afterward, known Al-Madinah as Al-Madinah after the migration of the Prophet ﷺ, or Al-Khaybar, who are about 173 kilometers from Al-Madinah. The main reason they migrated to the peninsula, anticipating the emergence of the final messenger whom they called the Messiah, and they were hoping that he would be among the Israelites. So anyway, Khaybar was a great settlement, and they had many fortresses, and they were very good in arm manufacturing, and in trade and business, in agriculture. So they were very well established. Khaybar, when these two companions entered there, they parted. reason or another, maybe قضاء والحاجة answer the call of nature. Then محيصة ابن مسعود started looking for عبد الله ابن سهل, his companion. And there he found him. But he found him dead. He was bleeding with a broken neck on in front of a water well, عين ماء. So عبد الله ابن سهل returned. عبد الله ابن سهل died. His companion محيصة ابن مسعود and his brother حويصة and عبد الرحمن ابن سهل, the brother of the murdered one, three of them went to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to complain. They said, عبد الرحمن ابن سهل said, my brother was murdered in Khaybar and. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم notes that حويصة and محيصة, the two sons of مسعود, were older. They said, wait a minute. Let the elders speak first. Let them speak and make the case. Who was with Abdullah ibn Sahl? Muhayyasa ibn Mas'ud. So he spoke and he made the case. The case is clear. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not need further clarification, especially that Abdullah ibn Sahl and Huwayyasa were not present at the time when Abdullah ibn Sahl was murdered. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to them, would you guys make 50 oaths? يعني would you swear to Allah 50 times? والله بالله تالله, we bear witness 50 times that the Jews of Khaybar have killed Abdullah ibn Sahl. Look at the honesty of Muslims. Look how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam educated them. How the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam raised his ummah on honesty, trustworthiness, even though the Jews of Khaybar were their enemies. And of course, they killed them. But do you have an eyewitness? Do you know for sure who killed them? No, we don't. But we suspect. Suspicion isn't enough. It's not an evidence. Okay? So the Prophet ﷺ said, well, since you don't even know and you cannot even swear, we cannot ask them for blood money even, which is 100 camel, by the way. He gave them those three companions now, Abdurrahman ibn Sahl, Huwayyisa or Muhayyisa, both the sons of Mas'ud, are considered the plaintiffs. They made their case. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, well, what if I ask the Jews of Khaybar to swear 50 times, or 50 of them swear that we have no clue who killed Abdullah ibn Sahl? So the three said, Ya Rasulallah, you know, those guys don't believe in God. If you ask them to swear to Allah, they will swear. They will happily swear to prove their innocence. So the Prophet ﷺ said, fine, no problem. And he paid them the diyah from Bayt Mal al-Muslimin. He paid them the blood money, which is 100 camels, as I said before. So even though the story is long and the hadith has many angles, but what is meant? And the caption, the hadith, is in the statement when Abd al-Rahman ibn Sahl wanted to speak, as he's the brother of the murdered one. Okay? But he was the youngest. So the Prophet ﷺ said, Kabbir al-Kibar. Let the elders speak first. Let the elders speak first. Somebody would say, come on, man, this is a murder. And the case is much bigger than the sunnah. And, you know, it was his brother. He's grieved. It doesn't matter who they speak first. No, it does matter. It does matter. If you truly love the Prophet ﷺ and you're really keen to be with him in Jannah, then you should simply study his sunnah, learn his etiquette. These classes, these sessions, and this course, and this series of Al-Adab Al-Mufrad is of a great importance. Not only to learn and get acquainted and to be aware of and say, yeah, yeah, I studied before and I know that there is a hadith, but to act upon it, to practice, to implement it in your life if you truly love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Also, we learn how the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam educated his companions to be God-fearing and conscious of Allah's presence and aware of Allah's presence at all times. Yeah, Yahud are their enemies, and who cares? Anyway, they are going to wherever. So if we take 50 or 100 camels from them, it is better than nothing. And who could possibly have killed them other than the Jews themselves? Do you have a witness? No, we don't. Do you have a proof? No, we don't. Would you swear 50? No, no, astaghfirullah. We wouldn't even swear a single time because we're not sure who killed them. We don't know. We weren't there. We haven't seen. So, okay. The Prophet ﷺ taught us, al-bayyinatu ala al-mudda'i wal-yaminu ala man ankar. When a plaintiff comes to the court and he makes a case against somebody, do you have a proof? No. So we go to the defendant and ask him, in order to defend yourself, would you swear to Allah that you didn't do this? You didn't harm the plaintiff? You didn't cause him any harm? I swear to Allah, I have nothing to do with him. Okay, he's innocent. Okay? Barakallahu fikum. That is the meaning of al-bayyinatu ala al-mudda'i wal-yaminu ala man ankar. The following chapter is Babu, إِذَا لَمْ يَتَكَلَّمِ الْكَبِيرُ هَلْ لِلْأَصْغَرِ أَنْ يَتَكَلَّمَ إِذَا لَمْ يَتَكَلَّمِ الْكَبِيرُ هَلْ لِلْأَصْغَرِ أَنْ يَتَكَلَّمَ. This is an important chapter, and it is very interesting as well. عن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنهما. But what is the title first? When an older person doesn't speak, can the younger one speak out? Hadith number 360, narrated by Abdullah ibn Umar bin Khattab, radiyallahu anhuma. An Abdullah ibn Umar, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, أخبروني بشجرة مثلها مثل المسلم تؤتي أكلها كل حين بإذن ربها لا تحط ورقها. فوقع في نفسي النخلة فكرهت أن أتكلم. وثم أبو بكر وعمر رضي الله عنهما. فلما لم يتكلم قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, هي النخلة. فلما خرجت مع أبي قلت, يا أبتي, وقع في نفسي النخلة. قال, ما منعك أن تقولها؟ لو كنت قلتها كان أحب إلي من كذا وكذا. قال, ما منعني إلا لم أرك ولا أبا بكر تكلمتما فكرهت. So beautiful. Abdullah ibn Umar رضي الله عنهما narrated that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, tell me which tree is like the Muslim. It gives fruits at all times by the permissions of its Lord and its leaf. Its leaves do not even fall. It occurred to me that it was the date palm tree. I thought it is the date palm tree, the narrator says, Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. But I didn't want to speak in the presence of Abu Bakr and Umar ibn Khattab, may Allah be pleased with them. And when they didn't speak, the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, well, it is the date palm tree indeed. When I left with my father, I said to my father, well, I thought that it was the date palm tree. So Umar Khattab, my father, said to me, what kept you quiet? Why didn't you say it? If you had said so, I would have preferred to such and such of the world. I said, what kept me from doing so, from saying it? It was that I didn't see you or Abu Bakr speaking, so I did not like to speak out. Here, An-Nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wasn't only teaching the adults and the grown-up, but the youngsters, everyone. And in his halqa and his meeting, youth used to attend, teenagers used to attend. I remember once when there was a big gathering and An-Nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received a gift, a bowl of milk. So the sunnah is to rotate it right to left. You know, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to honor his guests, his companions, by giving them of what he eats, what he drinks. He would even give them preference over himself. So, when the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam looked to his right, he found a young boy, Abdullah ibn Abbas, 12, 13 years of age. And then the Ashiyakh, The elders, Abu Bakr, Umar, Abu Ubaidah, Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, those old companions. So he said, son, would you permit me to skip you to give it to the elders? Then it will come back to you. Now we have two sunnahs. One, which is to begin with the elders. The second, to begin with whoever is on your right side. So he said, مَا كُنْتُ لِأُوثِرَ بِسُؤْرِكَ أَحَدٌ عَلَيْهِ. Smart boy, he said, there is no way that I would give preference to anyone to drink after you other than myself, no matter who is this person, not even my father. Imagine the Prophet ﷺ drank. So now whoever will drink will put his lips on the same spot, will drink from the su', the leftover of the Prophet ﷺ. What an honor. So the Prophet ﷺ yeed, and he gave it to him. He handed it over to him. May the greatest peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Here, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in a gathering, and he said, what kind of tree which is similar to a believer? In what sense? This tree is always useful. Its leaves never fall. Unlike the rest of the trees, during fall, the leaves fall and it becomes like naked, empty, subhanallah. And it produces plenty of dates. And even when it is cut off, we use it for building and construction. It's very powerful. It's always useful. And we use its leaves for making the roof and the ceiling and so on. So no one said anything. And I will tell you why no one said anything. Guess what? Even if they knew the answer, they would be quiet in order to see what would the Prophet ﷺ say. Maybe he would say something better than what they wanted to say. Or he will educate them with something that's superior to what they have in mind. So no one said anything. The young boy, Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, thought it is a dead palm tree. But out of politeness, seeing Abu Bakr, seeing Umar being quiet, he didn't say a thing. So the Prophet ﷺ answered, he said, indeed, it is the date palm tree. After they left, Abdullah ibn Umar said to his father, by the way, I knew it before the Prophet ﷺ said it. I knew that it is the date palm tree, but I hated to say anything since you guys were quiet. Umar ibn Khattab felt bad and said, I wish you have said it. It would have meant the world to me to see my son answering the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and giving the right answer to a quiz. Guess what, brothers and sisters? No one on earth likes anyone to be better than him or her, than the parents, who like the children to be definitely much better than them. We should revere, appreciate our parents, love and respect them, and understand that they only mean well. They do their level best to upbring us in the best possible way. They would rather go sleep hungry and make sure that we have eaten supper. May Allah be pleased with all our parents and have mercy on those who passed away among them. Well, we learn from this hadith that if the elders don't have anything to say, so the youngsters may begin speaking. It is time to take a short break, and inshallah we'll be back shortly. Please stay tuned. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته, and welcome back to the second segment of today's Gardens of the Pious, live all the way from Addis Ababa, Ethiopia. We have our phone numbers, which should be displayed on the bottom of your screen. If you have any questions, please dial any of the following numbers. Umma Imara from the UK. Umma Imara from Britain. Assalamu alaikum, sister Umma Imara.
Wa alaikum assalam, Sheikh. Hope you are well. I wanted to ask a question regarding the divorce of a person who was angry. And he gave, he uttered, I divorced you more than three times in the same sittings and in multiple occasions as well. would that be considered as a divorce? Because I read on a website called Farkas.app where it was said that Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn Qayyim, Al-Qayyim, they said that if a person is pronouncing in the state of anger, rather intense or mild, in such way that perturbation appears in most of his saying and action, and this perturbation prevents him from being reasonable and steady, then his mind and intellect are not altered, or he regrets his divorce after his anger is down. Such divorce, according to the soundest opinion of scholars, is not applicable. If you could confirm if the scholarly view of Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn Al-Qayyim is right on this or not.
Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala nabihi wa mustafa wa ba'd. Respected sister Umara, normally divorce questions should be presented by the husbands, the person who uttered divorce, because he knows better whether he was angry or really angry, or he was mad, or it was just a simple fight and escalated. So in this case, it all revolves around the intention. As far as the answer in general, what Ibn al-Qayyim and Ibn Taymiyyah, radiyallahu anhuma, may Allah be pleased with them. Ibn Taymiyyah is the teacher of Ibn al-Qayyim, obviously. They didn't say anything out of their mind. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the one who said that. When a person is in extreme anger, he doesn't know what he's saying, his divorce doesn't count. Whether he happened to divorce his wife once or 10 times. Under regular circumstances, Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim oppose the vast majority of the scholars with regards to the number of times if it happened in the same sitting and the person really means it and he's not in anger. This is where they differ. So he says that if a person said to his wife, "You're divorced, you're divorced, you're divorced," 3 times, but in the same sitting, consecutively, it only counts as one. So now we have 2 different matters to sort them out. This is where Abu Hanifa, wa Malik, wa Shafi'i, and others are of the view that it counts as 3. Okay? But Ibn Taymiyyah says it counts only as 1, because it's in the same sitting. And his opinion is correct, by the way. And it resolves a lot of problems and a lot of matters. But your question is about the state of anger, which again, I'm giving a general answer. And what you read on the website is a general answer. Then it becomes specific only when the person who uttered divorce confirms, "Well, I didn't know what I was saying. I was totally lost. I was like absent-minded. She drove me crazy." So in this case, he's liable for his statement, because if he happened to divorce his wife and he was not in a state of anger, which would nullify his divorce, he deliberately uttered divorce knowing it means divorce, then his wife is divorced. She will be okay, but it will be haram for him not to consider it a divorce, especially if it was the 3rd divorce. I.e., our general answer, in a state of extreme anger, where the person almost loses his mind, he's like mad, doesn't know what he's saying, divorce doesn't count. Divorce is not considered. Divorce is ineffective. Who determines so? The husband, the one who said it. The one who says, "I was in extreme anger, to the extent that after I finished and I calmed down, my wife said, 'How dare you divorce me?' I said, 'No, I didn't divorce you.' 'No, you did.' 'Did I?' 'No, I didn't think so.' Because he was absent-minded. You know? Barakallahu fikum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi. Atif from Bangladesh, welcome to Huda TV. Atif, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam, Sheikh. How are you?
Alhamdulillah, I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm fine, Sheikh.
What is your question today, Sheikh? Atif?
Yeah, Sheikh, I'm going to ask you a question. Sheikh, we know from a hadith that if someone drinks alcohol, Allah will not accept his prayer for 40 days. Can we apply the same hadith for smoking cigarettes? This is my first question. And another question is, a person who smokes cigarettes, can I make him as an imam of a mosque? There are two questions.
Okay, that's a good question. Question number one, is the hadith sound? Whoever drinks alcohol, Allah will not accept his prayer for 40 days. Yes, the hadith is sound. Does it mean that he shouldn't be praying though? No, he should be praying and begging Allah for forgiveness, lest he will die in a state of disbelief. Can we drive smoking by analogy to drinking alcohol? No, we can't. Okay. Thirdly, a person who smokes cigarette, should he lead the prayer in the masjid? If he leads a prayer at home with his wife and kids, yes. But to be an official imam, and everybody knows that he smokes and he needs a prayer, no, that is not permissible. Smoking is a sin. Smoking is haram. Smoking is a major sin. Smoking kills. Smoking is carcinogenic. Smoking, while alcohol is only harmful for the person who consumes it, smoking is harmful for the person who smokes and those who are around him. So it is definitely haram. May Allah guide us to what is best. So if somebody publicly announces that he is smoking, after all, he's committing a major sin. And he shouldn't be given access to lead the prayer. Barakallahu fi. Next question, please. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So we have Sister Tikat from Toronto, from Canada. Assalamu alaikum, respected sister, and welcome to Huda TV. Tikat.
Assalamu alaikum, brother.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
My question to you, that I did ruqya and someone in professional doing ruqya. He diagnosed like I have iron. So I have been.
Tikat, we lost you, Tikat. Okay, you want to try again, please? In any case, brothers and sisters, regardless what the diagnosis is, whether somebody is diagnosed with cancer, pulmonary disease, or stomachic, something minor or something major, it is a sunnah to recite ruqya upon them, to offer them to recite ruqya upon them. And it is a sunnah that they should recite ruqya upon themselves. I am having a stomachic. I put my right hand on my tummy and I say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min sharri ma ajidu wa uhadir, 7 times. Okay? And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure me. Allahumma rabban nas adhib al-bas. Ishfi anta al-shafi. La shifa'a illa shifa'uka shifa'a la yugadiru saqama. I don't know any of that, Sheikh. I'm not Arab. No problem. Put your right hand on your tummy. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Recite Surah Al-Fatiha. Is it a lot? Every Muslim knows Surah Al-Fatiha by heart. This is ruqya. So a ruqya is a supplication, asking Allah to cure you or the person whom you recite a ruqya upon, regardless what the diagnosis is. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Rida from India. Assalamu alaikum, Rida.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Assalamu alaikum, Rida.
Wa alaikum assalam, Sheikh.
How can I help you, Rida?
So my doubt is that I want to ask about the hadith Abi Dawood 3664.
Why don't you say the hadith? I don't know by number, of course, top of my head.
Just a moment, Sheikh.
Okay.
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if anyone acquires knowledge that should be sought seeking the face of Allah, but he
Now you
acquires it
start.
only to
Now
please
you.
them.
Assalamu alaikum. Rida, now you started breaking off. I don't get a word of what you're saying. Can you try again? Slow down.
Sheikh, my doubt is, should we gain knowledge? Can we gain knowledge for the purpose of making our parents proud? Or can we gain knowledge to please only to please Allah?
Okay. You could have made it easier from the beginning and just presented the question. Seeking knowledge in order to be closer to Allah is the ultimate goal. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the sound hadith, which is collected by Imam Bukhari, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَ. The best of all of you is the one who learns the Quran or any subject related to understanding the Quran and also teaches it to others after he or she learns it. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ سَلَكَ طَرِيقًا يَبْتَغِي بِهِ عِلْمًا سَهَلَ اللَّهُ لَهُ بِهِ طَرِيقًا إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ. Whoever treats a path in order to seek knowledge for the sake of Allah, the Almighty will facilitate his entry to heaven. So there is many prophetic ahadith, some even in Sahih Bukhari, emphasizing the importance of, when it comes to the religious knowledge, it should be sought, it should be learned, it should be taught exclusively for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anything comes after that, such as your parents will be proud of you, mashallah, extra. People will be proud of you. People will love you. People will come and attend your sessions. You will be learned, known in the community as a learned person or as a sheikha. All of that is plus. But my intention and my goal should be, number one, to seek the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Barakallahu fi kirida from India. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. More from Italy.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh. How are you?
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. More, how can I help you?
I have two questions, if you yeah. allow me. The first one is a confirmation. As we know, Allah is the only knower of the ghaib, so it's part of his knowledge, and his knowledge is not created. So when he revealed to us the knowledge of the ghaib to the Prophet, this is part of his knowledge, right?
Continue, please.
So when he reveals to the Prophet that they are the only people who can receive the knowledge of the ghaib from Allah, this is part of the knowledge of Allah, right?
No, the last phrase, I didn't get it. You said the only people, so, what?
The prophets are the only one who receive the revelation of the ghaib and the general revelation. And this revelation of the ghaib is the knowledge of Allah.
Mor, why don't you just present your question?
Is the ghaib the knowledge of Allah?
Of course, the Quran confirms that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُطْلِعَكُمْ عَلَى الْغَيْبِ. It's in Surah Al-An'am, it's in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3. وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُطْلِعَكُمْ عَلَى الْغَيْبِ. Allah is not gonna show you the unseen fully. And he said, عَالِمُ الْغَيْبِ فَلَا يُظْهِرُ عَلَى غَيْبِهِ أَحَدًا إِلَّا مَنْ اَرْتَضَى مِنْ رَسُولِ. Allah is the knower of the unseen, and no one has an access to the unseen or part of it except فَلَا يُطْلِعُ عَلَى غَيْبِهِ أَحَدًا. He doesn't show or share some of the unseen, the knowledge of the unseen, with anyone except those whom he is pleased with to choose as messengers. And final verse of Surah Luqman, the Almighty says, إن الله عنده علم الساعة وينزل الغيث ويعلم ما في الأرحام وما تدري نفس ماذا تكسب غدا وما تدري نفس بأي أرض تموت إن الله عليم خبير. So these five knowledges, when you look at them, they are truly representing the knowledge of the unseen. When will the day of judgment take place? No one knows but Allah, not even the messengers, not even the angels. When will the rain come, and whether the rain will come as mercy or a torment, fruitful or whatever, destructive, only Allah knows. Whether this girl, when she gets married, whether she will conceive, have children, or she will be sterile, and her husband will be sterile, how many kids will they have, boys and girls, healthy or with Down syndrome, only Allah knows. That's ghaib, completely ghaib. This child in the future, whether he will become a Nobel Prize winner, become a multi-billionaire, or he will become a beggar in the street, only Allah knows. You can guess, you can hope, you can wish, but the outcome, what will actually happen, is completely in the knowledge of the unseen. وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بَأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتٍ. I was telling myself for the past 10 days, because I traveled to several countries in just 10 days, I wonder if I die in Zimbabwe, or in Zambia, or in Zanzibar, or in Hong Kong, or in Addis Ababa. I don't know. What is going to happen? Where are they going to bury me? What will happen to my family? Should I stop traveling? Well, if you stop traveling, do you think that if you're supposed to be buried in Riyadh or Mecca or Medina, it will just happen? So that's called ilmul ghaib. We don't, argue with Allah with regards to al-ghaib. Any person who claims to know the unseen, such as what are the hidden things, what will happen in the future, even if this future is tomorrow, is a liar, is an imposter. So what about the prophecies that, like Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam prophesied, predicted this and this and this and that will happen by the leave of Allah? Wahy. And huwa illa wahyun yuha. Sunnah was revealed to him like the Quran. What about Al-Qadr? When he was teaching Musa alayhi salam things that Musa alayhi salam have no clue about. Very possible. Allah chooses whomever he wills in order to inform about some limited access about some of the unseen which people do not know about. Barakallahu fikum. More from Italy. Let me see if we still have time. Oh, we actually ran out of time for the day. Inshallah, I do apologize for all the callers who are still on the line. And I'm actually at the airport waiting for my flight. So inshallah, I will see you tomorrow for Amar from our studio. Inshallah, live as Kuda. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for all of us. May Allah accept our humble effort and grant us success. Pardon us and forgive us all our sins. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. التمور إن شاء الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
To them. So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about it in paradise. Worshipping cows, fire and stones. Selling the best with the cheapest price.
So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about hell and paradise. Worshipping cows, fire and stones. Selling their best with the cheapest price.
Rasulullah.